Another week, another episode of Colonial Sports Center. But as always, I'm Chris Baginski, alongside Ed Albert. And Ed, this week in Colonial Athletics was so big, so packed full of events, that we had to throw out the clock.
We did, Chris, mostly because of time constraints and so much highlights, but also our producer not being able to tell time was also a factor, but just so much action this week. We've got a lot to get to, and you've got Game of the Week. That was a thriller.
Absolutely it was. This week, hockey season begins, and our Game of the Week reflects that as we bring you highlights of the men's hockey team's opening matchup against Queens. Brooks Bratton will bring you more on that game later on tonight.
And if we take a look at last week's results, you see men's soccer was in action against Fairleigh Dickinson, going to the 0-0 draw there. And the women's volleyball team taking on the Central Connecticut State Blue Devils actually had the 2-0 lead in that game, went into the break and came out and then lost the three straight sets. So a heartbreaker there for the women's volleyball team.
You hate to see that, Ed.
American football, tennis, volleyball, field hockey, ice hockey, we've got it all on this edition of Colonial Sports Center, so you'd best grab a drink because this show is packed full of action, and we'll be back in a few.
Right down to football. Bryce, a whole lot went on this season.
But I can't go back now.
And I doubt that our Dean Taylor.
That is great.
Colonial Sports Center. You ready?
Job! Things have been a little stressful around here lately, and the Colonial thought it'd be a good idea to do some Tai Chi.
This week in Colonial Sports, the water, words.
Next.
She just looks amazing. I can't believe how did she lose all that weight? Excuse me. Today on Colonial Sports Center, we'll have an interview with
Joe. Next. Next.
Colonial Sports Center, you ready?
Okay, let's talk a bit of music here, people. In the classic 1975 Fleetwood Mac hit single, Rhiannon, Stevie Nicks sings the line, "Will you ever win?" You can take that line and apply it to this year's Colonial football team. They've had many close-fought games and some not-so-close-fought games, but the one thing that remains the same is the Colonial's win total, 0. They had a chance to change that against the Blue Devils up in Central Connecticut. Let's see if they could find win numero uno.
That's Spanish, Chris, for one.
You, sir, are smarter than you appear. Now, anyway, the Colonials are already leading 7-0, but Garrett Clausen misses his first field goal attempt here, but there's a penalty.
And if at first you don't succeed, Chris, dust yourself off and try again.
And Garrett Clausen would do that very thing. From 20 yards out, he missed that one, too.
Should have listened to TLC more.
Indeed, Ed. Now, the Blue Devils are going to get a punt block here, but look at that. That is roughness right there. I don't care what the referee said. That should have been a penalty, but it will go in the books as a blocked punt. Great field position for the Blue Devils, and Hunter Wankett finds a wide-open Brian Fowler for a 9-yard touchdown pass. Fowler's not done yet, though. In the second quarter, he pounds it inside for another touchdown. They'll miss the extra point, but it'll be 13-7 CCSU.
Fowler doesn't need Lee Corso at all.
Not at all. Now, the Colonials retook the lead 14-13 until the opening kickoff of the second half, where it's Jose Paul who takes it from the 5-yard line, and, well, just watch him. You're going to see that he's going to stumble a bit, but still he's able to outrun 3 white shirts all the way to pay dirt.
That's unfortunate.
And that makes it 19-14 CCSU. They'll go for the two-point conversion to go up by 7. And it's James Mallory rushing it in from the 3 to make it 21-14 CCSU. On to the fourth quarter. Wankett will pump once to the right, and then he'll throw over the middle. 40-yard touchdown grab by Rob Fisher. It is 28-14 CCSU.
Wankett looking like a cover version of John Elway right there.
Know how much you enjoy some music there, Ed. Later, Brian Fowler gets on the score sheet once more for the Blue Devils. And what a way to get it. That's the third touchdown of the game for him. 66 yards for a touchdown. 35-21 CCSU. But the Colonials scored as well. Camden Krause found tight end Shadre King to make it 35-21. The Blue Devils recover the onside kick. And they attempted to run out the clock, but Kevin Wolfolk breaks out to a 44-yard run, making the final score a double up. 42 to 20.
Just barely.
Jeff Sinclair was pulled early in the game. Camden Krause threw that touchdown.
What's better than a single tennis highlight? Well, how about two, as we have footage of both the men's and women's tennis teams in action against Loyola of Maryland. How did they do? Well, we're about to find out. So, Chris, Loyola, Maryland, the Greyhounds, not quite a Greyhound bus, but we're going to take a look at some tennis action. We're going to start here and... Well, it's the wrapping up of the 2009 season, and so we're just going to let you see that there.
Number nine.
Yes, number nine. And you see that there. And
it's six balls.
Yes, it is. We've counted it. First singles, we're going to start out. This is Andre Cairo of RMU taking on Kenyon Sanai. And Cairo just was on in this match, Chris, won 6-2 and 6-1, and you can see why. Very dominant.
Solid performance there. And he looks a bit like the drummer from the Yeah Yeah Yeahs, which is always a plus.
Obviously.
And he was able to take that first one. 6-2, 6-1, Ed.
So we move on to the second singles, and this is our buddy Dave Pinto taking on Pierce Norton. Sounds like one of your British friends, but he just plays for Loyola, and unfortunately that's all you need to know about Dave Pinto right there. That's an ace. Maybe see that one later on. So we move to first doubles, and this is the brilliant Brazilian Igor Neves taking on Norton and Sanai with Pinto, and they just were dominant, winning 8-4, Chris.
I'm not going to lie, Ed. Whenever I think dominant pairings, I think Lennon McCartney, Morrissey Marr, and Pinto Neves.
And that's just what you're going to get, as you see that one. That one, though, got to give Loyola credit, Chris, just sneaking that one in the back of the line there. But Neves and Pinto wouldn't let it faze them, and they just go on to win very easily.
No trickery there. Look at that.
Great placement by Pinto, and those two just have a great connection there. And there you see the entire team would go on to win. Robert Morris 4-3. And there you see our buddy Igor Neves, the pride of Brazil, the brilliant Brazilian, coming up with a victory 6-4, 6-3. And well, we got to move on though. The men weren't the only ones in action, Chris. So we're going to move on and talk about the women's side. And so they're coming up. They're taking on the Loyola Greyhounds. And Chris, it's the end of the 2009 season.
Number nine. I bet you there will be six balls.
I don't know.
Four, five. Where is it? There it is. Six.
Brilliant,
six balls.
Brilliant photography.
Which is nine upside down.
It is. Brilliant photography by Nazari Dorosh there. We start first singles. This is Janicek of Loyola taking on Carissa Chen for the Colonials. Chen would play a little bit well here, but it was just not enough as Janicek would go on to win 6-1. You can see Chen here going to get a good shot, and Janicek just hitting it right back, and Janicek was on in this match, Chris.
That she was. She just was able to control the play, and, well, whenever you're able to control the game, you usually control the score, and you come out with the win.
So Chen would go on to lose, however, to 6-1, 6-1. So we'll move on to first doubles, where it's Chen again. This time she's got her partner Sam Alaves going up against Janicek again, as well as Janicek's partner Swan. And it would be an even worse defeat, Chris, unfortunately, for the Colonials. That one goes into the net there. And this one just barely making it over as Loyola gets that one. Nothing but power there. And Loyola goes on to win 8-2. If you take a look at the scoreboard, it's not pretty. Loyola would win as a team 6-1. And Chelsea Fry has more with the women's, Jake Neal has more with the women's tennis team.
Courts against Loyola Maryland, both the men's and women's tennis teams met the end of their fall season. While the men's team showed extraordinary potential, the women's team has left much to be desired. With a loss of 6-1 to Loyola, the women's team has fallen to a 2-3 overall record.
Well, Loyola's a very good team, and when you're missing one of your starters due to injury, she couldn't really compete today. And missing another one of your usual starters who's out in Europe with taking some classes. It's tough to compete. I mean, we have four freshman girls and one sophomore girl. So they're going to have to grow as a group. They're going to have some tough times, but they're a very good group of players that in the near future will be challenging teams like Loyola and like hopefully like Quinnipiac and Sacred Heart, schools like that. They'll be able to give them a good run for their money.
This team has been dynamic in their play. Freshman Andre Coro posted 6-2 and 6-1 victories, while sophomore Igor Neves, senior David Pinto, and freshman LaRon Brown all posted wins against Loyola Maryland. Even more staggering is how successful the men's doubles teams have been. Coro and Aaron Haas finished with a perfect season of 4-0.
Doubles this fall has been great. It's kind of surprising because we haven't had that much practice time. I've been injured and I had pneumonia, so Igor's also been injured. So having a 4-0 record this fall is it's surprising. It's very good. And it's a lot of fun. It's more doubles wins than I think I've had in any other year combined, so it's been fun.
Overall success of the team is even more impressive due to what senior David Pinto calls some, quote, interesting years. If the team stays on this track, there will be some different kinds of interesting years to come. Jake Neal, Colonial Sports Center.
Thank you, Jake. On Saturday, the Colonials volleyball team did their best for Breast Cancer Awareness Month by having its inaugural Dig Pink match. So though both teams were winners Saturday, which one won the actual volleyball game? Let's take a look.
They call this the Chucky sometimes, Chris, as the Bulldogs come into town.
Hey, Bulldog, yet again, as the Colonials get ready for this matchup. We'll begin in the first set because that's where you usually begin, and it's going to be Amanda Craig serving. And you start off here with a good rally. It always seems like the earlier points are always like more competitive, you know?
It is, Chris. You know, we've seen a lot of those, and these points are always, they fight back and forth early, and then one team seems to take over and dominate.
But Alyssa Bennett can do more than just set. She got the kill on that point, and then she teamed up with Amanda Graham to pick up the block.
It's, could you say Graham Slam?
Something tells me you're going to be seeing quite a few Graham Slams in this highlight reel right here. But first, you're going to see Hannah Veith with that one. That is a quality kill. So, it was some back and forth action, but that was actually the deciding point as the net was touched by one of the Bryant Bulldogs. So we will go on to the second set. It's Craig serving once again.
Nice low service, by the way, Chris.
You always want to try and get those balls low so that they're harder to pick up from the ground and get over, but that is Graham's hit, unable to be handled. She's been wearing a cast lately, but it's colored pink this time.
She's been doing well with it too, Chris. Her play hasn't lacked one bit since that cast has been on.
And that is a Graham slam right there. Anyway, it was a straight set victory for the Colonials. Graham had 10 kills, 2 errors, and 17 total assists.
Regardless of the sport, it's always noteworthy when the Colonials face their cross-state rivals, the St. Francis Red Flash, out of Loretto, PA. Field hockey is no exception. The Flash visited Joe Walton Stadium, and our cameras were there, so let's take a look. So, the Red Flash and the Colonials going at it, Chris, and this match would go down to it. It's Chantel Crow here. She's going to get the ball over to Kylie McCain, unfortunately going wide, and it would stay scoreless here early on. Then it would be the Red Flash's turn. They're coming down. They're trying to score. It's Tia Dedukovic. And Super Seeley, Stephanie Seeley, kicks the pad out, makes the save, and we move on to the second period. Where the Red Flash are again applying the pressure. They try and work the ball to the net again. And Seeley is right there again, blocks that one away. She was the key to this game for the Colonials, Chris. Kept them out of it the entire time.
Numerous times she said, no, you may not get a goal.
And then after that, we have Dedukovic with a penalty corner. And watch what happens to Jessica Charles. Oh, takes one right off the noggin. Right above the eye, it looked like, on the forehead. Oh, look at the blood everywhere. being attended to by Jason Daly, the athletic athletic trainer. And take a look at this in slow motion. Oh, just a hard hit. She's carted away, would be okay, and she is going to play this Sunday, so we wish her all the best. But they would have to redo that penalty corner. And after that, the Red Flash are trying to get this ball into the net, and Seeley says, no, you're not getting it past me. We're going to win this one for Jess. And then we would move into an overtime. So the Red Flash are setting things up here. They were really pressing early in this first overtime and gets the ball past Seeley, and she says, no, nothing gets past me. The ref agrees. The ball went off a foot, and so St. Francis would not be happy about this one, but they would get another shot at it. So they take this second chance, and they try to work it to the net again, but Chris, guess who's going to be there?
Will it be Stephanie Seeley?
Yeah, there she is again. Just kicks that ball away, gets a nice clear from her defense, and then the Colonials, having a chance in this overtime to apply their own pressure, gets down and they work it to McLean again here, and she gets down and gets a good shot off, and it's just blocked away by Caitlin Vitale. So we move to the rare second double overtime.
Is it holographic rare?
Yeah, you hardly ever see that graphic come out as Vitale stops a charging Crow on that shot, and Crow gonna try again. Watch the stick work here. Moves in around one player through another, gets the shot off, and Vitale kicks that one away again. So we move on to penalty strokes. Haley Botha here, she's gonna be stopped by Vitale. And so just when you think the Colonials are out of it, well, you see number 14 walk into the frame, Steph Seeley. She pulls those pads tight, she's ready to go, walks into the net with confidence. The Colonials, they're not worried. And up comes Claire Wilk, and she's not gonna get the job done. Look at this, Seeley reaches out with the pad there, walks it away, not a problem there. And then she's gonna do it again, denying Caitlin Brown. And that would set up this play from
walk.
A confident walk. That would set up this play from Allie Flood. Puts this one away, wins the game. Everyone's energetic. Look at Seeley jumping up and down. Take a look at the scoreboard here. A 1-0 victory for the Colonials. They actually got outshot, as you see, 19-13. So able to overcome that. And right there, that is your top performer, Stephanie Seeley, with 19 saves. They couldn't have got that game done without her. She did a great job.
The Colonial field hockey team defeated St. Francis in a close game last Friday at the Joe Walton Stadium. Coach Nessler shared her feelings about the game.
I'm excited, but I feel like it was just such an exhausting game. I feel like the girls just gave everything that they could, that it could have really, towards the end, gone either way. It's more of a relief, I think, than anything, because we deserved to win from the moment we got out there. And, you know, the fact that we went into penalty strokes, you know, kind of, I think we could have taken care of it before then, but the fact that we've come out with the win, it's a relief.
The Colonials were happy to turn this conference win into positive momentum.
This is the third game of the conference, so technically it's 1-2, but it feels good to finally be winning, getting out there, changing the record around.
This crucial win helped RMU's defense by bringing confidence to their play.
One of my defenders, Sam Hayden, just had a total blinder. She played so well today, and I mean, I don't know, I think that they just came together on the right day. My defense is, they've gotten a lot of play this year, so they're very, very used to being strong and battling it out, and, you know, I think even today they stepped up again, and I mean, I'm proud of them, but I always expected of them. That's what they do.
The defenders certainly helped in this game, and the Colonials also learned some valuable lessons.
If anything, I think it's just taught us how to be tough. We know we can make it through a game like this. I think Sunday's game could possibly be very similar. So, you know, if we've had the experience and the other team hasn't, then that's only a positive for us.
Although this game ended positively, several players went out due to injury, but the Colonials still advanced in the game.
Big problem today was that one of our girls got hit in the head, and she was our main, hitter of the penalties. So it just, a lot of it comes from the push out. Once the push out is consistent, then the trap can be consistent, and then what comes after that can be consistent. But it's very, very hard because on the surface, it's very hard to get a consistent push out. The majority of the corners that we had today, we actually didn't have our hitter here, so we're kind of caught with girls out of position and playing where they never normally are. And the fact that we had two main players who had been hit in the head, it was just kind of, we just didn't have the numbers up there that we're used to having.
Down in numbers, our injured Colonials seem to be recovering.
I think Jess is okay. She's going to need stitches. You know, she got hit pretty bad. Anna's okay. She's going to have a very bad headache. So I don't know. Hopefully they'll be fine. But, you know, Jess is very strong, so she'll be fine.
We wish all of the players a speedy recovery and hope that the team's momentum only continues to increase. This is Chelsea Fry for Colonial Sports Center.
Thank you, Chelsea. Our next segment features a guy named Brooks.
But is it Orpik? Is it Like? Or is it Ostergaard?
Well, actually, it's Brooks Bratton, and he's next with the Colonial Spotlight.
It's 2 weeks in a row I couldn't answer your tricky trivia. Stay tuned.
We trained terribly hard in order to provide you with the best show possible.
Center. You ready? Here at Colonial Sports Center, we cover multiple Division I NCAA sports like football, lacrosse, rowing, and ping pong. Sports Center. You ready? Here at Colonial Sports Center, we train terribly hard in order to provide you with the best show possible. Sports Center. You ready?
Welcome back to Colonial Sports Center. I'm Brooks Bratton, and hockey is on the docket once again. The men's team took on the Queen's University Gales this past Friday night in an exhibition matchup down on Neville Island for a little preseason tune-up. How did they do? Let's head across the river and through the parking lot to the Island Sports Center for the matchup between Robert Morris and Queens. Junior forward Nathan Longpre wearing the A this season. He had 41 points in 36 games last year, looking to improve upon that. To the first period we go. Longpre's off to a good start, winning the opening faceoff there, but it gets even better. Zach Arvada to Longpre. The wrister beats goaltender Mackenzie Ball. 1-0 Colonials at this point, and there would be hugs all around. Queens comes back, however. Clinton McCullough down the wing gets off the backhander, and hey, you forgot something. Jonathan Lawrence with the gimme. We're all tied up at one. Later on, Colonial power play. Nice passing through the point. A one-timer from the circle and stopped by Ball. Cody Crichton banks home the rebound, but the men in the stripes say no goal. Later in the first, Furman South walks out from the corner. Snipe. There goes the water bottle. Colonial's back on top, 2-1. A little bit later, Nathan Longpre walking out from the corner. Check out the puck possession. In the high slot, gets off the wrister. Cody Crichton is there to pick up the garbage. This time it counts. Colonials take a 3-1 lead into the locker room after one. To the second period we will go. Colonial power play. Nice puck movement around the perimeter. Denny Urban gets off the shot. Stopped by Ball. It's going to come back out to the point to Longpre. To Urban with the slap pass to Trevor Lewis for the one-timer. Not quite. Nice defensive play here by Captain Dave Cowan, and then Brendan Blandina, well-executed body check there. Later on, a face-off in the Queen's zone. Again, the Colonials, some nice possession along the boards there. And eventually, Scott Kolbiakko is going to get it out to Ben Finney with a wrister tipped in by Chris Kuznarek. Colonials take a 4-1 lead here, and they would go on to beat the Gales of Queen's University 8-4, the final. Junior forward Nathan Longpre off to a great start there. The Colonials outshot the Queen's University Gales 31-19. Derek Schooley was asked what he thought, how he thought his team played in the game, and also about their upcoming trip to Alaska.
We had some things we did right. We had some things we did wrong. It was a typical exhibition weekend. We need to be better this weekend, though. Well, you know what? It's a long trip. It's cold. It's all the way north. I see Russia from there. We have great success. We went up there 2 years ago, winning both games. So hopefully we can continue that trend. Okay. And
he can see Russia from his house. 6'4" defenseman senior Dave Cowan has been a mainstay on the Colonial Blue Line for the past three seasons. The Calgary Alberta native finished with 4 points last season, and this year he's got the C on his sweater. The Colonial Spotlight Athlete of the Week is Captain Cowan.
Time to play the game!
Hi, I'm Nathan Longpre. This is Colonial Spotlight. So this is what we're up against. So this is what we're up against. Face it. This is what we're up against.
Dynamic, creative, but plays hard, and that's the thing that sometimes you get some skilled guys who don't play hard, and he plays hard, and he's a very good hockey player for us, and that's the reason why he was picked all preseason league.
I got into hockey when my dad first put skates on me when I was 4 years old. Ever since then, I've been playing hockey all my life. My favorite NHL team is Montreal Canadiens because my dad was a big influence in that. He had always had Canadiens on TV when I was growing up. And my favorite player from that team was Maurice Richard. Hi, I'm Nathan Longpre. This is Colonial Spotlight.
That was Nathan Longpre, not Dave Cowan. But it's that time again, so run to the freezer and grab a Klondike. Coming up, it's the top five plays of the week. Showstoppers is next.
Mr. Producer, you had two late tape rolls and the audio was late four times or so. Prime Cuts definitely got the best of you tonight.
Prime Cuts? Prime Cuts. Prime Cuts, Peter? They are who we thought they were! That's why we went live! If you want to crown them the best show on campus, then crown them! But they are who we thought they were! We let them off the hook!
Mr. Spencer, one question, please.
Yeah, go ahead.
Why are you shirtless?
Good question. Spencer out.
So for Chris Baginski, I'm Ed Albert. We'll see you right back here next week on Colonial Sports Center. Good night, everybody.
Take care, everybody.
And that's a wrap.
Anything is possible! At least he kept his pants on this time.
Hi, I'm Chris Walker, producer of RMU Live. Here at RMU Live, we take bringing you world